Please sit down.
Mr. Tanay Shankar.
Yes.
Why do you wish to join the civil service?
Sir, among the services, the Indian Foreign Service is my first preference. And I really wish to represent India on the world stage. During my student exchange semester, I got a chance to present India, make a presentation on India's culture and soft power in front of a classroom consisting of people of many different nationalities. And I really enjoyed it.
Good, very good.
And I really enjoy interacting with those people.
Very good. And so what qualities do you possess which will make you a good civil servant?
Yes, sir. I have a high degree of adaptability to diverse circumstances.
Adaptability, what else?
Sir, I am very dedicated and focused on my goal.
Dedicated and focused.
Yes.
What else?
Sir, I am open to learning new things. I am very inquisitive.
Inquisitive. What else?
Sir, I persevere through adverse situations and remain calm in stress.
I see. You can handle stress. But you know, these jobs are top jobs in the country. They are, in some ways, they have leadership. These are leadership positions.
Yes.
You are representing your country. You will be a district magistrate. You see, you will be a police officer, senior police officer. If though that is not your choice, it seems. But you haven't mentioned any of those qualities which are required in a leader. Adaptability, dedication, etc. is very good. These are good qualities, but those qualities you have completely forgotten. So you keep in mind how you will handle this issue.
Okay.
Now, next is, since you say Foreign Service is your first choice, what are the main objectives which India through its foreign policy is trying to achieve? Main objectives. Give 3-4 main objectives.
Sure,
and there is a difference between the path which India is taking and the goal which it is reaching. I am talking of the goals, what we are trying to achieve.
Sir, the first one I would like to mention is diplomacy for development, for economic growth, because as the economic survey points out, exports is one of the sustainable engines of economic growth, and we are trying to increase our exports and international trade.
So, improving trade,
yes,
is one of our goals.
Yes.
All right. Improving trade is our goal. Improving exports.
Yes.
What else?
So, the second I would put is a solution to problems which are transnational in nature, such as climate change, terrorism.
Right. Like anything else?
So the third one I would like to mention is that we have one of the highest diaspora in the world among all countries.
Uh-huh.
That's around 30 million strong.
Mm-hmm.
And
so protection of diaspora.
Yes, sir, for the safety and security.
Right. Are you missing something here? In these objectives, some very vital objectives.
So if ever to talk about specifics, probably a permanent seat in the Security Council is
permanent seat.
And,
but you are still missing something.
Sir, a membership of the NSG.
Don't you think, what is your most serious problem in the field of foreign affairs?
Sir, our neighbor.
Your China and Pakistan,
Pakistan
are your perpetual enemies.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
So don't you think that is the first priority? The first priority. You'll do everything. You'll go for seed in NSG everywhere, while your own home will be destroyed. No?
Yes.
Isn't that your first?
Definitely.
Right? So, think of it. You're not able to articulate properly. First thing is security and safety and sovereignty of our nation.
Yes.
Protect that.
Yes.
Second is economic development. Right?
Yes.
Third is military, our strong military.
Yes.
We must collaborate like Rafale, etc.
Yes.
Those are the basic objectives.
Yes.
Other things are peripheral, like objectives, Security Council. Even if you don't get a seat in Security Council, so what?
Mr. Tanay.
Yes.
Tanay, right?
Yes, sir.
Now,
you are interested in the foreign service.
Yes.
Let's look at our relations with China. There is a concept of string of pearls. What is that?
Sir, it can be defined as a policy of encirclement of India through Chinese ports and naval bases, starting from Djibouti in Africa, then Maldives, Hambantota in Sri Lanka.
Where do they have a port in Maldives?
Sir, they don't have a port as yet, but they have acquired land.
Okay.
Then Hambantota in Sri Lanka, Chittagong in Bangladesh, and Kwak Pyu in Myanmar.
Now, who was the person who propounded this theory of string of pearls? Was it the Chinese, the Indian, or what?
Sir, I am not too sure the name of the person, but he was not either Chinese nor Indian. I think he was an American.
Booz Hamilton.
Booz Hamilton.
Right, they are the ones who did that. Now, our relationship with China, there are a large number of irritants in our relationship. Border issue, of course, is a very, very major one. Now, China is spending a lot of money on this CPEC.
Yes.
How much money are they spending on that?
About $60 billion.
Billion. Dollars?
Yes.
Yeah. So what is, why are they spending so much money on this corridor?
Sir, the first, one of the reasons I think is because China's state-owned enterprises have excess capacity and they want to utilize it in infrastructure projects.
That is the primary purpose of spending all this money, because they have excess capacity?
That is one of the reasons.
Okay.
And the other one would be more strategic. That
we'll come to the strategic first. So what is the strategic advantage of the CPEC for China?
Sir, I think it would be one of the major stepping stones to its improving its cooperation with Pakistan.
Why they don't need to have any steps to improve? Why for improving the relation with Pakistan, they are spending this money? I am asking you, is there any strategic advantage for China per se by building this CPEC?
So they have a port at Gwadar in Pakistan.
And so what does it do for them, for the Chinese? What is the importance of Gwadar?
Sir, I think it's also a part of the string of pearls.
That too?
Yes, sir. And
look at it this way.
Yes, sir.
China imports a huge amount of crude oil for its requirements.
Yes, I get you.
Where does it go through? How, sir, does it go now?
Sir, it goes to the Strait of Malacca, which, yes, is a choke point for them.
Choke point, apart, the distance is huge.
Yes.
10,000 kilometers.
Yes, sir.
And what is the distance from Gwadar to Xinjiang province?
Around 3 to 4.
3,000 kilometers. Yes. That is the most strategic advantage. That is why they are doing it.
Yes.
The rest, of course, is there. Yes. Pakistan becomes dependent on them, and they have been supporting Pakistan.
Yes.
On many issues. What are the issues on which they have been supporting Pakistan against India?
So one of them is to block India's membership in NSG. Second one, I would say that India wanted a resolution to be passed that Azhar Mahmood should be declared as an international
Masood
terrorist.
Azhar.
And that was blocked by China.
Who is Masood Azhar?
He is in Jaish-e-Mohammed.
Yes. Yeah. And what has he been responsible? Has he been responsible for any attacks in India?
I think 26/11.
That was Jaish-e-Mohammed. That was not Jaish-e-Mohammed.
That was LET.
LET. Something else. What is this theory of separation of powers?
Okay. It was first given by Montesquieu,
correct?
French political, yeah, scientist. And it refers to the separation between the functions and responsibilities of the three branches of government, the legislative, the executive, and the judicial.
Is the US an example of separation of powers?
Yes, definitely.
There is. What is this problem which they are facing, this federal shutdown which is happening in the US? What is the background to this?
President Trump,
yeah,
he wanted, as a part of his campaign promise,
mm-hmm,
he wanted a wall to be built between USA and Mexico. And for that, he requires $5.7 billion. And that the budget for that needs to be voted by the House of Representatives. But since the majority is of the other party, the Democratic Party, they are not allowing it to be passed. As a result, there has been a standoff.
How much money does he need?
$5.7 billion.
One last question. Yesterday, a very major sporting event has ended in Pune. Have you read about it? Khelo India Youth Games.
Sorry, sir, I haven't.
You have. Are you following tennis?
I don't follow tennis.
Thank you.
Tanay.
Yes.
You have done MBA.
Yes.
MBA in what? What was the major subject?
Sir, in IIMS, we don't have any specialization as such, but I took many electives of economics and finance.
Okay. So, anyway, management teaches you to be a good manager. And you are aspiring for civil service, they are leadership positions. What is the difference between manager and a leader?
Yes, sir. I would say that a manager is one who is comfortable with the status quo and tries to manage it better, whereas a leader is one who is a change agent, who wants to change the status quo, and he or she also inspires.
Change the status quo.
Yes. That is, he wants or she wants to bring about a better status in the organization or the place where they are.
Like what?
So should I give you an example?
Yes.
I think if we talk about the world of business.
No, because leaders are not in business. Government positions, mostly not. You earn positions, they are not to do business. Think of, this is a very important question.
Okay,
because you have done management. Okay. Political science is your subject.
Yes.
Can you tell me what are the 73rd and 74th constitutional amendments?
Sure, sir. The 73rd constitutional amendment relates to the Panchayati Raj, local self-government in rural areas, and the 74th constitutional amendment relates to urban local self-government.
Okay. So, can you tell me some of the important features of these two amendments?
Okay, sir. Before this, there were many states which had local bodies, but the structure was not uniform. Some of them had two tiered, some of them had three tiered. Now it's a uniform three tiered structure, subject to an exception of a population of 20 lakhs, I believe. And
what are the three tiers?
So the first one is village panchayat.
Yes, yes.
Then after that, it is third is Zilla Parishad, and in between it's
Panchayat Samiti.
Panchayat Samiti, yes.
At block level.
Yes, sir.
Be very sure, because these are very important. Public administration and political science is your core subject. Then, what are the features? That is, this is three tab.
Yes, sir.
Then, what are the other features?
Sir, it has introduced the 11th and 12th schedule into the constitution, which has a list of functions which can be transferred by the state government to these bodies.
How many? Functions have been transferred so far, not having that list 11 schedule which you have read.
Yes,
any idea?
Yes, sir. The 11th schedule for rural areas has 18 functions, and for the urban areas, it has 29 functions.
Correct. So then, go ahead.
And apart from that, it also has provisions related to the reservation for the underrepresented classes and castes, and as well as for women, at least 33% reservation should be there for women, these bodies.
Yeah.
Then it also has a list of taxes or revenue sources for these local self-government bodies.
You are missing two important points, that is periodic elections.
Yes.
Every 5 years. That's why the State Election Commission.
Yes.
And
state finance.
Okay, now you have talked of 33% reservation for women.
Yes.
So now there are many women sarpanch.
Yes.
So has the women empowerment or the kind of the sarpanch, are they really taking the leadership positions, or what is the position? It is not a criticism about that.
So there are two sides to this. On the positive side, it has been seen. So if my home state is Bihar, there it is 50% reservation.
Okay.
And it has been seen that since women leaders take decisions more related to the health and education, which are more priority areas.
Okay.
But the downside of this is that there has been this proxy leadership kind of thing, where the actual power lies with the male members of the household, which does not fulfill the purpose for which this reservation was put in.
One more question I'll ask. You know, since independence, you name three or four major achievements India we have achieved. Three or four major achievements in different fields.
Yes, sir.
Since independence.
Okay, sir. Sir, I would like to put our advancements in space technology.
Space technology, okay.
ISRO has done very well, and
okay.
The second one I would like to put is that at the time of our independence, across the world, there were many doubts that whether we would be able to sustain a democracy in a newly independent country.
So
but
a strong and vibrant democracy, yes. You are saying. Okay, then go ahead.
Then third, that economic growth has been very good in these years. We are now the sixth largest economy in the world in terms of nominal terms.
Achievements, I am asking, because you know this is a development, but you know, self-sufficiency in food.
Yes, that is definitely.
Nuclear, India became a nuclear,
yes,
power.
Yes.
Then of course, the 1991 economic reform. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You have presented a paper on a possibility of a common currency.
Yes, sir.
How practical would this be for the ASEAN countries?
Based on my studies, I found out that the level of economic development among the 10 members of ASEAN is too varied, and as of now, one single uniform currency for these countries is not suitable. Having said that, there are two different blocks among them, CLMV countries, the lesser developed ones, and the other countries, and among them, Brunei and Singapore already have a common currency arrangement, whereas Thailand, Malaysia and Indonesia have signed a framework for financial arrangements. So probably, based on my studies, I can say that a single currency is not practical.
So taking a leap from the European Union, would you say there are certain pitfalls?
Yes, ma'am.
What would these be?
The first one would be the role of an anchor country. So in the EU, Germany has been playing this role. The problem is that is in the terms of fiscal deficit. So Germany has always been very fiscally prudent and has restricted spending. But countries like Greece used to have a lot of spending areas like salaries, pensions. So this has created some conflicts.
And the point of bankruptcy.
Yes.
Okay, you also have taken part in a lot of quiz competitions.
Yes, sir.
How do you view the quiz competitions which they show on our Indian TV? Have you seen any of them?
Ma'am, I was part of one.
You were?
Yes.
Okay, what do you think about them?
I was in Tata Crucible campus quiz.
I saw.
Yes, ma'am. So, it's supposed to be a business quiz in the campus edition, but there are many questions on the general areas as well. I think the prime reason for that is to keep the interest of the viewers, but it has tried to work out a solution that in the corporate edition, they only ask business questions. So they have tried to balance it.
Okay. Now you also visited a large number of countries and you appreciate cultural and historical sites.
Yes.
So if I asked you to compare the temples of Angkor Wat with the Egyptian temples, let's say of Luxor, what would you say? Have you visited them?
Neither, I haven't visited them.
Either of them?
No.
But you visited lots of places in Cambodia recently?
No, in Southeast Asia, I've been to four countries in Southeast Asia.
Alright, so tell me something about your visit to Southeast Asia.
I used to live in Singapore for 2 years. During that time, I visited Bali in Indonesia and Kuala Lumpur and Genting in Malaysia. And recently, during my MBA internship, I was in Thailand for 2 months. So this is a recent experience.
So Thailand, you didn't visit any of the other places around Thailand? I mean, in and around Bangkok, or you just
I did.
You did?
Yes, ma'am.
Anything you'd like to say about that?
Yes, ma'am, definitely. I visited this place called Kanchanaburi in North Thailand near the Myanmar border.
Yes.
And it is the site of the bridge on the river Kwai. Not the one shown in the movie, that is actually shot in Sri Lanka. But it was built by the prisoner of war during the Second World War. And I visited the site, I travelled on the Death Railway as it is known. And there were many Indian prisoners of war there who also contributed to.
Okay, you also invested in movies, since
yes.
you talked about Bridge on the River Kwai.
Yes,
there's a movie Good, Bad and the Ugly.
Yes,
it's supposed to be one of the classics of black and white films. Why is it so relevant even today? Why is viewership so high for this movie?
I don't remember the specifics.
Okay, you haven't remembered. Alright. Now, coming to the pharmaceutical industry, because you work there, what is the health of the pharmaceutical industry in India? How is it doing?
In terms of generics, we are doing pretty well, but there have been some issues related to FDA inspections. Some of the sites have not met the standards and they have faced certain sanctions. And the second aspect is, from my own experience, I was working at Dr. Reddy's and a large share of our business was in Venezuela. But then a currency crisis happened there and Dr. Reddy's lost a lot of its revenues because.
We come across the term evergreen
drugs.
What does that mean?
So, when a new drug is developed by an innovator company, it has a patent protection for 20 years. But what happens is some of the multinational corporations, they make minor modifications to the drugs. And then they try to again apply for a patent. But India does not allow that.
And recently there was a controversy about the capping of prices for drugs. What was that about?
So in India, the price of drugs are controlled by drugs DGPO, and although it's a very good step in terms of increasing affordability, but there is a supply demand problem there. It creates situation of scarcity. That is the
okay.
Thank you,
Mr. Tanay. Corporate governance issues are rather weak in this country. Right? Of late, some attempt has been made to strengthen the corporate governance norms. Can you throw some light on that? What kind of improvement is coming in corporate governance?
Sir, I know two things about this. One, there was a panel led by Mr. Uday Kota, which committee led by him, which went into this issue. And then.
Company law amendment?
Yes.
Okay.
But I am not too familiar with the specifics of this.
Okay. But probably. From a layman's perspective, what kind of shortcomings do you find?
So I think there is an issue related to conflicts of interest which must be removed from corporate governance.
Accountability of the directors?
Yes.
And shareholders are also not given the kind of importance which probably they need to be given.
Okay.
I'll change the subject. Insolvency and bankruptcy code, how significant is that?
So it is very significant. It's a major it's a step in the right direction as far as reforms are considered, because India has this burgeoning NPA problem. And apart from that, in the economic survey of 2016, we talked about Chakravyuh challenge, where firms are able to enter but they face problems in exit. And this code,
has it made a difference?
There is one case that has been resolved, that was of Bhushan Steel, I believe. Other cases are going on.
Some criticism is also coming the way the code is being implemented. What kind of criticism have you occasion to go on to the newspapers?
I don't remember.
The process of resolution is very slow and I think riddled with a lot of. Anyway, so since I think it's in the beginning phase, one can give them some degree of liberty. Okay. Universal basic income, what is this concept?
This was again the economic survey and it talks about transferring an amount to the Jan Dhan accounts of every person. And it
In the context of a country like India, I think it's a practicable.
We have a huge population, and then apart from that, the digital infrastructure in every rural area is not that developed that.
Okay, last question.
Yes.
How do you look at the fiscal situation in India?
Sir, if India has been enacted FRBM and we have been striving to reach the 3.3% fiscal deficit mark, and currently we are around 3.3 to 3.5%. So yes, we are going in the right direction. However, in terms of subsidies, we still have, and crude oil vulnerability, we still face.
Is there a real threat of overshooting the target in the current year?
Yes, as far as I recall the newspaper reports, by November itself we had surpassed 118% of the budgeted fiscal deficit.
And there are still a couple of months more.
Yes. So there is a possibility.
And what happens if we overshoot the fiscal deficit target? What would be the consequence? Just one.
Yes, two of them are there. First is borrowing will increase either from internal or external sources. And secondly, if there is a deficit financing by printing more currency, then inflation will be there.
Sovereign rating will also
come.
Okay, thank you.
You have done management, right? So, what is the best way of managing your resources, which includes manpower? What are the best ways of doing it, according to whatever you learnt, theories, etc.? What are the resources? Resources are physical resources, money, etc. And then you have the manpower. So what are the best way of you would suggest?
From what I've learned, if there is a resource in a company, it should not be kept idle for a long time. There should be optimum utilization. And as far as human resources are considered, so for any company, I think empathy with the employees is very important.
Right. Now, which theory of management would be most practicable for application to, let's say, IAS, a job which a collector holds, or a police job? In a government organization like these, which theory can be adopted for best management of resources?
Sir, I am not able to understand which domain of management.
You know broadly the job which a collector does, yes, and the job which a police officer does.
Yes, sir.
Both have, number one, both have to control many wrong things,
yes,
right?
Sir.
Controlling. That is administration, and then collector has a wider brief, that is welfare and development. So which are the theories now which you think will be most applicable, or is there no theory which you can think of?
Sir, I'm not able to recall any theory.
Any theory of Peter Drucker you can use?
No, sorry.
You have read those theories?
I know Peter Drucker's name, but
you haven't read these. Then whom are the great management gurus which you have read about?
I read about Michael Porter.
Michael Porter?
Yes.
What is his theory?
So he talks about five forces in any industry. And can I list them now?
Quickly.
Threat of new entrants. Bargaining power of customers, bargaining power of suppliers, inter-firm rivalry.
All right. No, yes, you know it. It's okay. Now, Bihar, what is the growth rate of Bihar?
From the last figures, I recall around 12%.
12%. And Human Development Index, where does it stand among the states?
I think it stands for 34th.
34th.
Well, states and UTs.
Right. Absolutely. You have a very excellent bio data.
Thank you, sir.
And very rich CV. Practical experience is also quite good. From 2015 to 2017, you've been working. All that will help you in answering a number of questions. We feel that most of the questioning is going to be based on your bio data. On your job. So political science and international relations are your subjects. Then you are foreign service is your first choice. So we have accordingly focused a large number of questions on these areas. On political science thing, you should also keep in mind things like constitutional principles, like basic structure, or qualities, federal or unitary. It is federal with unitary bias, etc. And you have to give reasons why, if they ask you. Then important issues which have come up before the Supreme Court in, let's say, last 1 year, like Aadhaar, privacy, triple talaq, euthanasia, living will, etc. And now issues like surveillance over computers. So these are some of the important issues. Lokpal bill, what is Supreme Court said about Lokpal. Then also appointment of CBIG and appointment of DGPs. These issues have also come up. So these are important areas. Next is your chemical engineering. Now, since you have worked in ready laboratories, Aditya, the laboratories and chemical engineering, this is some area where you should expect questions. One question which occurs to me, I mean, you should prepare among other questions, is like you were asked about the evergreening of patents, right? Now, you know that famous Gleevec case in India?
Yes, Bayer. Novartis.
Yes. So that is a very important case in the Supreme Court laid down what entitles a company to brand its good as for patent. So read up that, and in that connection also read up India's patent law. But this is a very famous case which you should keep in mind and refresh your memory about it. It says that incremental improvement is not, there must be a substantial,
increase in therapeutic
efficacy. Inefficacy.
Yes.
Then your hobbies, these are important things. We have asked you questions on management, leadership. I asked you about management theories. We asked you about 73 amendment, 33% reservation. These are all questions of relating to our constitution. India's great achievement, these are important. We asked you also about ASEAN and CPAC. Now, CPAC, there's something I would like to tell you finally. You're very well informed. It is clear you're well informed. But you are not able to distinguish between what is important and what is less important. So in your answers, you're all going about peripheral issues more. For instance, you were asked a question of CPEC. What is strategic? Strategic is, it is not that China is helping Pakistan for any altruistic reasons.
Yes.
It is getting a strategic benefit out of it. Same way, what are the objectives of India's foreign policy? You're going for minor things like energy and security council. What is our most important pursuits? What do we want out of this
security?
So, is there a case in Kuwaiti? Separation of powers also you were asked, which is a question of constitutional. Whether in India do we have separation of powers? That question can be asked. So, finally, we would say that you are a very strong candidate, but you need to clarify your priorities in the sense. When you are giving a presentation, focus on the important, cut out the unimportant.
Sure.
Okay. Good luck.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel. And press the bell icon to never miss an update.